Hi, and welcome to Next Level Carpentry. I'm Matt Jackson, and in this video, I'm going to unbox all the hoses and fittings I got from Air Handling Systems for hooking up and connecting the Harvey Gyro Air G700 dust processor to the various equipment I have in the shop. While researching for the various types of pipes and hoses that are available for hooking up dust collectors, and in this case, a dust processor, I came across Air Handling Systems. When I contacted the guys there, they had seen a demo of the G700 dust processor, so they knew exactly what I was talking about when I asked them for help in figuring out the various hoses and components and fittings that I'd need to efficiently run the various equipment in the Next Level Carpentry Shop. Their knowledge of dust collection systems in general and of their product in particular really helped to streamline the decision-making process as I went through the various things I felt I wanted to accomplish, and then what systems or what parts were available to accomplish the setup that I was after. When I explained to them that this system would be featured on Next Level Carpentry, they offered me a promotional rate on the fittings for discussing them in the video. But I want viewers to know that I contacted them because of interest in their product and the features they had available. The main thing is a heavy-duty, clear, anti-static hose. And it wasn't them contacting me and saying, hey, we'll throw a bunch of products at you if you'll brag about us on your video. So with that little bit of background, I asked Chip to stop by and open some boxes. He wasn't here for unboxing the dust processor, so I wanted him to be around to open up these cartons and see the cool stuff that the guys at Air Handling Systems sent for hooking up the first ever dust collection system I've had in the new Next Level Carpentry Shop. Hey, can I open up these boxes? Yeah, you want to open the boxes? Go ahead. Really? Knock yourself out. Sweet. I love big boxes. What's this stuff? That's the 4-inch hose right there. That's the piece I have for the final run into the various machines. Huh, cool. I got a 25-foot length so that I could cut it in half and use for two separate runs that can be hooked up at the same time, even though only one of them is actually sucking air. Looks just like the other stuff. Yep, you're right, that's 6-inch stuff, just like the 4-inch stuff. Awesome. It's a full 30 millimeter thick, extra heavy duty hose. Air Handling Systems has other hoses that aren't quite as robust. They're plenty useful and flexible, but I thought, well, I want this to be extra durable for the use I plan in the shop, so I went with the heavier gauge. But the 6-inch is much like the 4-inch. It's an anti-static hose, so no extra ground wire is necessary to prevent the buildup of static that'll shock you when you walk to and from your machines when hooking them up and disconnecting them. And that last box has got all the goodies in it. Kind of making a mess over there, buddy. Like a kid on Christmas morning. Lord of the Rings. Looks like you're about down to the bottom there. Yep, and that is a custom Y fitting with special tabs welded on there. I talked this through with the salesman at Air Handling Systems, gave him a simple drawing, and they were able to fabricate that Y fitting to suit my specific needs here in the Next Level Carpentry Shop. I've not seen it done this way before. The difference is that I'm planning on having the duct system just laying on the floor in between machines when I'm working with them, but then everything can be disconnected and rolled up when I'm welding or painting or doing other things in the shop. So the setup for that Y fitting is a little bit unique here, and time will tell if it was the right thing to do or if I'll adapt to a different system later on. Looks like that's about it. No wonder nothing rattled. I think I'm gonna go get some more of those Christmas cookies. Yeah, hey, knock yourself out. There's lots more of those cookies where those came from. And if you don't eat them, I'll have to. You can deal with this stuff. See you later. Thanks for coming by. All right, well, I'm going to zoom in and take a closer look at these parts and explain a little bit more in detail what they're for and why I chose these particular ones for the initial setup of this system. Well, I've kind of got these parts organized after Chip went and flipped them all out of the box. I feel like I should be doing a cooking show or something here, turning on burners and sautéing some eggs or something. The parts that come out of the box, this is the 4-inch, 30-mil anti-static flex hose. It's got a copper or copper-coated wire in it, and there's something about the plastic that discourages static so that no extra grounding wire is necessary. I'm told that when I'm moving these between machines that I don't need to anticipate a static shock every time I walk up to the hose. So the 4-inch, there's 25 feet. You can buy this in either 12 and a half or 25 foot lengths. I bought a 25 and I'll cut two separate legs off of this hose during the setup. This is heavy duty. They make, I believe it's a 20 mil, which is a lighter duty version of this. It'd be a little more flexible, but I figured for the extra durability, I don't have to be quite as careful working around this stuff. And when I get in the thick of a project, I don't want to have to worry about a fragile hose. So I got the 30 mil. It's heavy duty stuff, a lot of rebound to it. And the plastic just feels durable and not brittle or brittle. I'm told that rubbing this stuff around on a rough concrete floor over time will tend to wear through the plastic down to these ribs, but much slower on this heavy-duty hose than some of the lighter non-industrial grades that are available at a lower cost. But in this case, I just want a robust system from the get-go. So that's the flex hose. There is a product catalog that came with the shipment. Most of this stuff is on the internet on their website at airhandlingsystems.com. A full selection of stuff and some of the fittings, the custom fittings that these guys are able to make to suit customer needs directly are pretty amazing. I don't know where the page is here. I'll include a still shot of it in the video of some of these tapered things with all kinds of arms sticking off them for various machines and equipment. I'll zoom in a little closer for these parts here and kind of go through them in order of importance. First thing is Lord of the Rings here. Screw-on hose clamps for attaching flex hose to machines and fittings. I'm too short of these 4 inches. I need to get a couple more for the whole setup. The next item are these adapter rings. These allow for connecting flex hose to blast gates. The blast gate just has a narrow lip on it, and it'd be difficult to get a hose clamp to hold the hose on that short lip. So this piece extends the lip so the flex hose can be put over this wider part of the flange and hose clamped on. I've got enough of those to get the hoses hooked up to the outlet ports of the blast gates. Next thing is these adapters, and these are made for a standard 3 7/8 inch nominal dust port. All the equipment in here, bandsaw, joiner, table saw, and this is from a DeWalt DW735 thickness planer. This fits snugly on and allows a quick disconnect of the hose to the machine. So I've got one of these parts here for each of the machines. This just stays on the machine. When it comes time to bring a flex hose to the machine, the flex hose gets clamped to this side of the fitting. The hose butts up to this rib, gets hose clamped on here. This fitting is permanently part of the machine. And by slipping this together and then using these spring clip attachments, I'm easily able to move the hose from one machine to the other, which is a setup I think is really sweet. Because of the nature of this shop, I'm not having a permanent hard duct system where everything stays hooked up all the time and I just go from machine to machine with blast gates. This has a combination of these quick disconnect fittings and blast gates. I've got enough of those setups to switch between machines pretty quickly. One of those. I have three of the full 4-inch blast gates. The gate in these is held in place by a thumb screw, either in the open or the closed position. And there's a number of varieties of blast gates. I chose this model partly out of optimism and partly out of ignorance. The downfall of this is that there's a slot where this blast gate slides in and out of in the bottom. And if that slot gets packed full of sawdust, they caution against using this type of blast gate with woods that are wet or pitchy, because that groove is more likely to get impacted with debris and prevent the gate from closing. These gates are able to be disassembled to clean that out, but they also make a gate with an open slot in the bottom so that the chips, anything gets pushed out the bottom and won't plug up the gate. And they also make a half duct gate with just a rounded bottom that fits into the bottom of a pipe, so there's no slot at all. This is my first attempt. I'll see how I like them and fill you in. One of the things I realized right away is that with a fitting on here, I'm not thrilled about having to reach down and turn this thumb screw each time that I decide to switch from one machine to the other. The hose can stay hooked up and I can just switch from one blast gate to the other to direct air to one hose or the other. And I don't want to have to turn a thumb screw to hold that gate in the open position every time. So I've got a workaround for that that I'm not sure is novel or not, but I'm planning on using it to make this system more flexible. I'll talk more about that workaround later. So blast gates, I got one little blast gate, and this will be for hooking up an auxiliary vacuum port, or maybe to a miter box or a drill press or a router, using a smaller piece of flex hose. I didn't get the hose or the adapters for this because I'm not quite sure how I'll integrate that into the system, but I wanted to plan ahead for it. Let's see, this part is just a 6-inch version of the quick disconnect. And I'll use this to connect and disconnect the main trunk line from the dust processor into my system network. And here I have a branch line with a 4-inch line going through to one of the big machines. This will get a blast gate on the 4-inch side and a blast gate on the smaller side. If I close this and open that, I can use that auxiliary vacuum line at some point in the future. That's the plan. And because I'm a little bit of a newbie at this, we'll see how my best laid plans fare. The last fitting I got is this cool one. It's a Y fitting. It goes 6-inch from the main feed line from the dust processor, and then it branches off into 2 4-inch lines, so I can have two machines hooked up, and with blast gates here and here, I can switch off between table saw and joiner, or joiner and thickness planer, without connecting and disconnecting the hoses. I think that that'll be a thorough enough setup that I wouldn't want 3 hoses hooked up all the time and 3 blast gates. I think 2 is going to be good enough, but we'll see. What I really like is that Air Handling Systems was able to create this custom fitting. A 6-inch Y with 2 4-inch legs is fairly routine for them. It might even be a stock fitting, I'm not sure. But what is unique about this is these 3 tabs. And I wanted those drilled tabs welded on here because I'm going to make this splitter section of the dust processing hose network, I'm going to make this rigid, and these tabs will allow me to mount this to a board. And I think they'll include that little bit in this video as I get the system set up. But with a couple simple sketches, I was able to communicate what I needed for these tabs. They fabricated it just like I ordered and made it up and sent it out with the shipment. And you can tell by the noise this makes. This is not tin. This is heavy-duty steel. If I step on this, it's not going to crumple. But then it's not so heavy that it'll be awkward to move around. But that pretty well covers all the pieces, parts for the order. I'll go through making the plate that'll secure this, and then do a little bit of shot of actually putting the fittings together and hooking them up with hoses. The junction point on this dust collection system is comprised of this Y piece with 2 4-inch glass gates, and then 2 of the blast gate to hose adapters. And I'm advised to keep the seams and any roughness out of the bottom of the tube so that the airflow for the chips is the smoothest. And then I'm going to have the 6-inch fitting on this side so that I can quick disconnect the hose from the machine to the rest of the duct system. So this is the final configuration of the fittings for the Y section of my dust collection network. I rotated this fitting so the clips are on the sides. I also rotated the blast gates down 90 degrees so that the gates work horizontally instead of vertically. I think that might work better, but time will tell. So I want to make a nice solid base for this to mount on to make it more usable. I'm going to show you the extent that I'm willing to go to make something like this. Even though this base is somewhat temporary in nature, I want to do a nice job of it. And because I hate sanding and messing around, I'll make a quick pattern for the part. And rosin paper will work nice for a pre-patterned pattern. I thought about a few options, making a circular base or a rectangular one, but I thought in the end that I would just make a roughly Y-shaped one here and see what that comes out like. So I'm just going to roughly trace this out on the rosin paper for a good starting point. And then I will smooth out some of these curves. Nothing specific about this. It doesn't take a genius to figure out that I'm winging it here. Use that for a center line. This end will be square. The center line. Put a square reference line up here just for grins. How about a couple of them? And the splits of these Ys are going to be 45 degrees, so I'm just using a 90 degree reference line to make a 45 degree face where that one leg of the Y will come out. Put a little more sweep to this. This is a 6-inch pipe, so the pipe will be 3 inches. We want to cover this mounting tab here, so let's start out with 6 inches on either side of this. Draw a parallel line, and we'll just blend this in with a quick curve here. Something like that. Fold the pattern on the center line, which you can't see. Come up with that. Put this on a scrap piece of wood. Cut the straight parts. Let's get wild and kind of crazy and cut all the parts. And that step right there gives me a nice symmetrical Y pattern that will make a good base for this. I'm going to make my first iteration of this out of a piece of MDF core birch veneer maple, just because I have some on hand. If I really like it and decide not to change it, I will probably make this up out of a piece of phenolic that a friend and viewer has turned me on to. So we'll see how things progress, but for now, I will take one more step in showing the lengths I go to avoid sanding by creating quick patterns. The overall dimensions of this are going to be about 24 inches by, call it 22 inches. So I'll rough cut the piece of 3/4-inch MDF for the whole thing, but to simplify the pattern making process, I'll cut a piece 12 by 24 and make half a pattern so that it can be flipped. Well, I shuffled through my leftover material sheet goods and came up with a piece of 3/4 inch maple faced MDF core material. I'm using this because it's stable and it's pretty heavy. It'll be a good balance for that Y connector. So I've got a 22 by 24 inch piece of that. I've got a piece of 1/4 inch MDF, happens to be maple faced, that'll be used for the pattern, and have the pattern itself. So with these three things, I'll whip up a quick pattern. And true confessions, I didn't really feel like firing up the dust processor for just the few cuts it took to cut out these scraps, but I did. Hey, the video's about dust collection after all anyways. So I need a little more than 11 inches for half of this pattern. So I have a square corner marked here, just for sure. And I'm gonna mark 11 inches for a center line for the pattern. The pattern center line. On this piece, which I cut a little less than 22, I will go a little less than 11 for the center line on this. 10 61/64 to be exact. I hope nobody believes me on that. And then I'll just place the pattern paper on the pattern stock and secure it so the center line pencil line lines up on both. Like that. I want this face to be an accurate 45 degrees. I'm just doing that. And because I know my pattern material is square and my pattern paper is stubborn, I'll just mark this 45 degree angle with a speed square and override the template if need be, but that is going to be plenty good. This will be a parallel line right here. This will be a parallel line. And all I'm showing here is that the pattern gets me where I want to be for the curves, but the straight geometry, I can easily supersede the pattern and still end up in the right place. And one of the trickier parts of a pattern like this, where a curve goes through a center line, is getting a nice sweeping curve through there. Sometimes I can guess the curve when making half a pattern. When I fold the pattern out, sometimes the center line dives in like this, and sometimes it goes like this. And in that case, I'll just true up the smooth sweep of the curve at this stage. But this time, it looked pretty good. So that's the end of the paper pattern, but I'll keep it for placing the three mounting holes if necessary. And once I get past the center line, I want to sweep the curve away from its intended landing point. I think you'll see why later. But these straight cuts I can make on a table saw. This one I'll actually make on a miter box. And I can do this quite quickly and accurately because I know that this piece is as close to a perfect rectangle as need be, and 45 degrees on the miter box will cut this off. Got to make it easy on yourself because nobody else is going to, right? Because of the nature of this finished piece, I'm over-dramatizing the accuracy of this piece. It could be within 1/4 inch of this and be fine. This is a good way to go through the steps for a template that would need to be accurate. And yes, I'll leave the arrow shot from a table saw mishap in there because you can clearly see that a better way to do that would be to use a push stick to push the piece out. And because the blade is cutting farther on the bottom of the sheet than the top, I start well short of the tangent point of the curve. Now that I've eliminated the straight cuts necessary for the pattern with circular saw blades, I'm left with only two easy curves to do to finish up the pattern. I should make these two cuts on the bandsaw, but I'm going to use a jigsaw to prove two things. First thing is that you can make very quick and accurate templates with nothing more than a jigsaw. You don't need a $2,500 bandsaw to do this sort of work. And the second thing I'll prove is just how lazy I really am when it comes to work like this, because I don't feel like digging that bandsaw out just for a couple of cuts. How about that? I actually proved three things with that process. You can use a jigsaw for cutting patterns. I'm kind of lazy, and no matter how good I think I am, my camera battery can still die out right in the middle of video shooting. How about that? All right, well, we survive. Here is the pattern ready for a little fine tuning before we cut the actual piece. Some of you have seen me make curved patterns before. I'll use the same process here. And just about the time I say I never use these rubber sanding blocks for anything, along comes a job like this, and I need one. So I will munch on a piece of humble pie and use a rubber sanding block. Note, though, that I'm using it backwards because I want to fair this curve. I'm using 36 grit sandpaper to quickly smooth up the irregularities left by my sloppy job with a jigsaw. I have the pencil mark from the paper pattern on here to go by. Notice that I'm using a crosshatch pattern and moving the block in both directions at the same time. That tends to average out those bumps. If I just sand across, I get waves in it this way. If I just go straight up and down, sometimes it just smooths them out. But a crosshatch pattern really averages things out in a hurry. Straight sanding right at the end really smooths things out. The trickiest part about a pattern like this is getting a nice tangent transition. It's real easy to have a bump or a dip where the straight line dips before it curves. So getting a nice feathered transition from a curve to a straight is a little tricky, but you can do it. And ultimately, feeling with your hand is a better indicator than looking with your eye or following a pencil mark. Very small bumps show up quite clearly that way. And I'll hit this with 36 to get it smoothed up. I think you can still see that. Maybe I'll change the camera angle a little bit. This is one of those things where it's hard to work and shoot at the same time. Let's see what we can get. Because this pattern doesn't fit to anything, I just want it to be smooth and even flowing. It doesn't have to match up. It's a little harder to do half a pattern, but I just want this to be a tangent when I flip the pattern for the other side of the piece. Once it gets past the center line, it doesn't matter. It'll just trail off. And this is surprisingly more difficult trying to maintain a camera angle than just getting in front of this and doing the work. And I can flip the 80 grit to true this up, and that's not so the router bit will go smooth, but it's so my finger can feel better if there's little variations in the curve. I'm liking that. Got here, that'll work. I'll buy that. And as an afterthought, I want all these corners on the finished piece to have a nice little radius to them. So I'll do that right here and now with this 80 grit sanding block. So that I don't have to fuss with it on the thicker piece when it's done. I apologize to any viewers who find this part somewhat redundant and routine, but I've marked the center line from the face of the pattern down the edge, and we'll mark the workpiece as well. Then I'm just going to line up the pattern centers on the workpiece centers like that. Trace out the pattern. Just flip it over, line the center marks up again for the other side. And trace that out. That way, I've made a whole paper pattern, a half a routing template, and end up with a full workpiece that's perfectly symmetrical, or as symmetrical as you can get with manual methods. Of course, somebody could program this into a CNC and be relaxing in front of the fire with a glass of hot cocoa while I'm still out here making sawdust. But just like before with the pattern, I'll do the initial cuts as far as I can with the circular saw blades and then finish up with a jigsaw. And I'll leave a little margin outside the pencil mark so that the router makes the final cut instead of trying to get the router cut and the saw cut to come tangent perfectly. I'll make the majority of both these straight cuts with the table saw, stopping well short of the place where the straight line intersects the curve so that the bottom side of the blade doesn't cut into the workpiece. I cut that pretty close. I should have left a little more margin, but it'll be okay. That's a little more reasonable. And now, back to the lazy man's bandsaw, or maybe it's the poor man's bandsaw. And I explained this pro tip a long time ago when I was cutting elliptical ends on joists for a pergola. But as I'm cutting with the jigsaw on this thicker material, I'm being mindful to push this direction on the saw. So that if there's any deflection in the blade, it goes out away from the workpiece. If I'm trying to correct the cut and I end up pushing the saw this way, the blade bends like this. It'll end up cutting into the workpiece on the bottom side. So when you router this, the edge doesn't clean up. But this edge is flared out ever so slightly this direction. The other thing I'm trying to do is not cut into my table. You can see that I don't always succeed, and I nipped the corner off with a router not so long ago. I was going to point out that this is way too close. I'm going to barely get away with that. I can still see the pencil line, but it's just plain old stupid not to leave a decent margin because it all routes off the same, and if I go too far in, I've got to shift my pattern or remake the piece. So do as I say, not as I do. And interestingly enough, or maybe coincidentally, this pattern's looking a little bit like a t-shirt. And speaking of t-shirts, you'll see that I'm sporting my very own DeWalt BS1000 measure once, cut twice t-shirt. Those are available through the banner right below the video. It should be on there. It links directly to Teespring. And the main reason I'm bringing it up now is because the shirts run a little small. This is a large on me. Normally a large is good. The next one I get will be an extra large because this is a little more snug than I like it. So if you're into that sort of humor and care to get a shirt, you can get one along with some BS1000 mugs, etc. But this doesn't look like a coffee mug, nor will it, so I'm going to route this off to clean it up. This next sequence will be familiar to viewers of Next Level Carpentry. I'm just going to square the center line down the face, or the edge of this, where the jigsaw cut through. It's already marked on the other end. This way the pattern lines up on here. You could use double stick tape for this if you like. But anytime I can get away with it, I use a number 18 by 5/8 brad. making sure my center lines and this bottom edge are perfectly flush, like so. Tacking in place. The magnetic tip on the hammer minimizes the number of black fingernails you get, but those can be achieved other ways, so the magnetic hammer doesn't protect you completely. But because the pattern is solid, the material is solid, those nails hold positive. Two nails is plenty to keep this pattern in place while routing off that small margin of wood going around. Most people would probably chuck a pattern bit into a router and a router table. That would work fine. More power to you, but I much prefer my old Bosch number 1618D handled router with a flush trim bit in it. The bit is set so the cutter cuts through the 3/4 inch material with the maximum amount of bearing following the template. So I'll lower this a bit more. I just flip the workpiece over. Notice that the guide bearing bit will sweep in on this extra curve and come tangent exactly at the center point as it follows out across the leg. And I guess it's a bit ironic that I'm doing this process without the aid of a dust collector. So the next best option is to wear a dust mask. In the future, I'll have the dust processor set up to the table router and maybe use that as my reason for using it instead of the handheld. Once the first half of the pattern is routed, just extricate the pattern with a putty knife and a twist. Tap out the two nails. I do need to re-square the center line because that initial pass routed off the last one. Just like that. And I'll see if I can run the router and the camera with a little more grace on this second side than the first side. And with that Chernobyl cloud of router dust blowing into the atmosphere, that phase of this project is complete. Well, as the dust settles, I'll set this back on here to give an idea how this is all going to be mounted. I'll raise it up a couple inches just to make everything easy to connect and disconnect, but not so high that it makes everything easier to trip on. And I will use the holes in these tabs to locate where this gets screwed down and use a square in the center line to get this oriented properly on this piece. And I don't think I'll go through all those steps for this video. That's pretty routine business. But I'll pick it up again when I've got the hoses ready to clip onto all this and hook the machines up. Well, this is what my finished part looks like. I routed a thumbnail edge on it all the way around to keep it from chipping, sanded it up, cleaned it up, and sprayed a coat of clear lacquer on it. I put three threaded inserts in here for bolting the Y duct to, and then made spots for some plastic feet to stabilize it and keep it from getting scraped around on the floor. So with that pattern process, you can see that this really isn't a whole lot of effort, even though this may only be a temporary piece. It's a nice looking piece, it's solid, and it's gonna be effective. Plus you get to see how another application of patterning and templating with MDF and pattern bits can work. And I asked Chip to stop back and assemble this part while I just say that for you, anybody that skipped ahead to this part in the video and missed the pattern part, that's what we made. You can always jump back and watch the process if seeing that part makes you curious. But from here, as soon as he's got that put together, I'm going to go about hooking up the 6-inch hose coming off the machine to the Y, and then the various fittings to the machines. So we'll get to that part in a little bit here. Not much to it, huh, Chip? Something like that? Yeah, looks great. I think we're ready to go. Thanks. Yeah, cool. Well, I'll catch up with you later. This little saddle haunch here will give stability to this end of the Y duct assembly in case it gets stepped on, which is entirely likely. First thing I'm going to do for setting up the hose is to remove this clear plastic Y fitting that came with the dust processor. I may incorporate that somewhere else in the system at another time, but for now I'm removing this. I can also remove the ground wire since the new hose is anti-static and this isn't necessary. This ground wire is a piece of stranded copper wire that I affixed to the machine when I was nervous about static electricity from the get-go. Turns out it wasn't that big of a deal, and thankfully now, not even necessary. This is the box of clear 6-inch 30mm anti-static hose from Air Handling Systems. After a discussion with a particularly helpful salesman, I chose this as the material I'd use for this first setup. If you look close, you can see arrows on here. That's either the top of the pipe or the direction of airflow. I'm going to assume it's the direction of airflow and hook the other end up to the machine. I've got the arrows pointing towards the inlet port on the machine. I took a pair of pliers and bent this stiff wire so that the end tab of it is actually sticking in. When I install it on the inlet port, that wire won't be sticking out ready to hang up on something. I'll slip a 6-inch hose clamp over this and work it onto the inlet fitting of the G700. And I'm using a 5/16 socket instead of a slotted screwdriver for this. Once I have everything looking like I like it, I can snug down the clamp. And as you can see, I had to cinch down that clamp pretty well to fit around this outlet port and get it strong enough so that it doesn't just slip off. With one end of this 6-inch flex hooked to the machine, I'll take the adapter fitting off the Y connection and get this installed in the other end of the hose. I wanted to trim the end of this hose a little bit. The cut from the factory is a little bit uneven, and I want to get a nice clean end on here for the final setup. And it's copper plated wire, but it's stiff spring steel, so it makes the hose rigid. So I snip the wire, and I'll clean up this plastic with snips here. Some very tough material, and even with sharp shop snips, it's a little tricky to get at the cut. Tough and hard to cut is exactly what I want for this stuff. Here again, I'm going to bend this end in a little bit to make sure it's never sticking out and poking in ready to catch a shirt sleeve or a pant cuff. And on this fitting, the hose goes up to the rib that goes around. There it goes. Just using a flat-bladed screwdriver as a bit of a shoehorn here. So the outside diameter of this fitting must be a little bigger than that on the intake port of the machine, because it didn't take as much clamp pressure to snug that down for a nice tight fit. Well, with this main 6-inch hose hooked up to the machine and to the quick change fitting, I can wheel the G700 down the other end of the shop. Which was my intention from the beginning, so that this trunk line can run up here towards the machines and be hooked to the splitter. Hey, yo, down here. Well, the gyro air is going to live down this end of the shop, probably up against this wall, ultimately, when I get all this stuff organized. So I've got the 6-inch trunk line running out here. I've got this box of the 4-inch hose, and I got 25 feet of it. So I decided to cut it into 3 sections. Time will tell if I'm right or wrong. But I will cut a 10-foot hose to come from the joiner over this direction. I'll cut an 8-foot piece that'll go to the table saw, and I'll have a 7-foot left over, which I think I'll probably attach to the thickness planer because those are the machines I use most commonly. But time will tell if that's right or wrong, but I feel really good about the setup initially. So I'm going to get this hose cut into lengths. A brand new cutter in this knife. Which helps to reassure me that this is some tough hose. Well, I might be slow at this and not have any experience, but at least I'm doing a really bad job. But with the end cleaned up and this wire, spring wire turned in, more or less out of harm's way, I can install one of these hose adapter rings here. And I'm sure that you can see in here the effort that's required to get these things to mesh up. While it makes it difficult to get set up in the long term, I'm confident of the durability of the setup and the airtightness of this. Might be able to put a little lube on there of some sort. And I may choose to do that on some of the future fittings, but for right now I'm just wrestling with them for a nice tight seal. You hardly have to put any torque at all on that hose clamp with as snug as that fits. But that gives me one of my blast gate end setups. And this will stay hooked up to this Y fitting. For all this testing, I'm just press fitting these joints together. There's a section in the parts manual that describes how to set these fittings up. It says very specifically to use clear silicone in the joint and then put 3 steel pop rivets with steel pins roughly 120 degrees apart to secure the fitting and hold the silicone. I'm interested to learn that using screws is not a good long-term solution for this because the dust chips on a heavily used system will wear those screws out over time. So once I'm confident of all the connections and the setups, I'll secure these joints like it says, but in the meantime, I'm going to run them like this and see if I want to make any changes, and they'll be easier to undo and redo without a permanent attachment. With the blast gate adapter fitting in one end of the hose, I'll use this 8-footer as an example and install the quick disconnect fitting in the other end of the same hose. And that fitting is considerably more agreeable. That should work out great. So there's the dust processor with the 6-inch hose running to the Y with dual blast gates, and then a 10-foot hose that's going to run over and hook up to the joiner. With the aid of these quick connect fittings. And that is pretty sweet and simple. So I've got this grand experiment all set up, and I'm ready to fire up the dust processor and watch it pull some dust through here. But you remember at the beginning of the video, I mentioned my lack of desire to get down and turn this thumb screw. Every time I want to switch back and forth from one hose to the other, because that is just not going to be efficient overall. So the workaround I came up with, yet to be proven, but looks promising in theory, is to ditch the thumb screw altogether and instead use a rare earth magnet on this aluminum blast gate. It seems to hold the gate in position just fine. I've got a stronger version of magnet here, which puts quite a bit of resistance on that blast gate as it slides. I've ordered 10 1/8 inch thick by 1 inch magnets. I'll put two on each of these blast gates and just hope that my theory works, because this is sure a whole lot easier than fussing with a thumb screw. So I've got both thumb screws out, magnets in place, both blast gates are in the closed position. I'll fire up the G700 over there, and once suction gets built coming through this hose, I'll switch the gates and pull all the chips that are built up inside the joiner, and we'll watch them flow through the system here. Fingers crossed. Well, this system looks like it's going to work pretty slick, all told. Obviously, I've got a lot of miles to put on it, but I'm standing in the middle of the shop. Got 1,100 CFM of suction power going on there with a 2-horsepower motor. And you can tell by the sound of my voice, all you're really hearing in here is rushing air. There's a little bit of whistling here because I haven't siliconed these fittings together. That'll go away once I am confident of the setup. And even standing next to the machine with it running full out on one or the other of those machines, this is pretty sweet. For a small shop, this level of noise is completely bearable, especially because sawing boards, planing boards, thickness planing, or cutting boards on the miter saw, all those machines are going to make more noise than this ambient dust processor noise and its airflow. So I'm going to walk over and shut this off. Just because I can. Air compressor taken off on the other side of the shop. So with the flexible dust hose set up like it is, I'm able to use it, test it out, see if I like the configuration I've come up with. I think by sliding these hoses off to the side, they're going to be as unobtrusive as any dust collection system retrofit in a shop like this is. I suppose in a perfect world, I would have a rigid duct running under the floor with small hoses coming up the machines, but that's not the way it is here. But I want to say overall that I am quite pleased with the choices I've made so far with Harvey Industries and the G700 dust processor, along with the help and materials I got from the guys at Air Handling Systems. I think that this is going to be a really functional first system ever. I'll just see how things roll out and share with you as time goes on what changes and upgrades I've made, and a couple other snippet videos that I hope to make. I'll show how I made a retrofit housing for under the table saw to enclose the motor and get better dust gathering ability from the machine. And then because the dust processor is parked clear at the other end of the shop, I got the wireless remote control system retrofit for the G700. I'll show how that gets installed in a short video soon so you can see how that works out. Machines that are in stock now, as I understand it, do not have this installed. Maybe it's installed as an option. I'm not quite clear on that. But for sure, next year, new models will be available with the remote control installed before shipping. But it's a pretty simple process, and I'll go through that in an upcoming video. So with this set up to this level, I'm able to work with the machines. I've got a couple projects that I've got to get to. I may shoot a video on a little build project that I've promised for quite some time, but I'll talk more about the system, the way it works, and what I think of the decisions I made to get to this point in future videos. If you found this video helpful, insightful, informative, or maybe just entertaining, I'd ask that you'd consider subscribing to Next Level Carpentry if you haven't already. It's free, and you'll be notified anytime a new video is uploaded to Next Level Carpentry. I always appreciate comments, feedback, and insight from viewers, especially longer-term subscribers who've been with me as the channel has grown to this point, which right now has got to be crowding 63,000 subscribers, which is a huge move from a year ago. So I want to thank all the old and newest subscribers. I hope you continue to find worthwhile content here. I'll work to continue to provide it and see how it all works out going forward. So thanks for hanging out with me in the shop today. And until next time, thanks for watching.